Hi, my name is Steve Faulkner. This is Real Magic Review, and this is Blackpool 2020. So this is day three, day two of the whole days, but day three if you include the first night of the close-up competition and all that kind of stuff. Yesterday, the first half of the day was me. I got pulled into some, pulled in sounds bad, that's a really good thing. I got invited, that's a better way of doing it, isn't it? Invited to be on a panel with Luke Dancy, which was really lovely, about social media, which is great because I'm at the beginning of my kind of social media journey, I suppose. And that was nice because that got it was good practice for me to talk about stuff, and also good to get the awareness of the channel and the Club Magic course and all that. Oh, by the way, like, subscribe, etc. You know the drill. And then I got asked to do a podcast from a magic company that put in a podcast down, so that was really nice. So I didn't really get to see any of the early morning stuff. And what I realised from day one, the biggest mistake is trying to see everything. This is a convention that has arguably too much stuff on. It's not a bad complaint to make. But what tends to happen is, if you're not careful, you just go from one thing to the other without any breaks, and you get to a point where you just feel like you need a breather. So we kind of went to Pizza Express and for a coffee yesterday, and that was like, felt like, just to get out of it. And that's not that you're getting out of something bad, it's just you feel like you need to process what you're seeing. So yesterday was a little bit, I kind of decided I had to miss some stuff. Today's gonna be the same. There are certain things that I really wanna report back on, really wanna talk about, but I just cannot see everything and have the time to edit the videos, get the videos out. But I have heard, you know, I'll report back on what I hear. I've got people, friends that are sort of telling me about stuff that they've seen. So there's kind of recommendations that I think after this, through the next few videos and live things, if you ask me questions, I'll be able to answer some questions, even maybe about the stuff I haven't seen. Dealers as well, lots of people are asking me, you know, what's the best trick? Again, when you're seeing stuff, you don't get time to go around the dealers. I have been around all the dealers a few times, and you know, other than the stuff I mentioned yesterday, there are a few things I'll talk about at the end of this video, but also I think afterwards when we're home doing the live stuff, I'll be able to sort of, I've got stuff to take home and play with. And look at and review, and then we'll do some kind of impromptu quick reviews before we get to the main ones, because there is a lot to talk about. I'm going to talk about what I saw yesterday. I'm going to talk about something very, very special that I saw yesterday in a minute, which I think I want this main review to be about. But first up, the first thing I really sat down and watched was a bit of Jay Sankey. I've seen Jay Sankey for years. You know, he is someone, as many of us know, maybe if you're new to the game and you haven't been into magic that long, you don't know how prolific Sankey has been. He is someone that over years has just put out so much stuff, to the point where I think sometimes it's easy to forget how good some of that stuff is. And his lecture yesterday, well, first of all, he's very, very comfortable on stage. He's very energetic. He's still got that energy, you know, with age it hasn't gone. And he is very, very knowledgeable. He is someone that, as well as being prolific, has performed for a long time. So even though he's got all this stuff, his lecture was very, very practical. The first trick was a trick using sort of, you know, standard kind of switches, double lifts and two cups where the card would change to another card with an Erdnase change. And just very magical, very, very commercial. And his whole lecture that I saw, I came in and saw bits and pieces. So I probably watched about 20 minutes of the whole thing, you know, using the idea of a bill switch, but not with a bill, turning it into someone's name. You know, all this stuff with an eye, as I say a lot, with an eye on stuff that works and is fun to do. And the thing with Jay Sankey's material is that most people will be able to do it. Like, I think he said the hardest thing in his routine was a one-handed top palm. But obviously you don't even have to do a one-handed top palm, you can do a normal palm, and it's all done with misdirection. It was all done at a time when there would be no heat on the hands. So really good. The real shame was that he did all his tricks, and then he talked about stuff that you could buy, and then he gave these eight pieces of advice, these eight secrets, if you want, magic. And it was all about performing, and it was all about, you know, keep your eye on the audience. And one of them was funny, it was, you know, make sure you master a really good fake laugh. And be yourself. He had a lovely line, which was, you know, something like, I'm going to kill it, but something like, magicians are happy to reveal cards, but they're not happy to reveal themselves. So that was the real gold. And the real shame was that at that point when he started out, you could see people kind of getting up to buy the stuff to make sure they didn't miss out on the package. You know, it's all about the package, which is very good, but you're kind of missing the good stuff there. That was good. Before that, actually, a lie, I did see Ben Hart. I saw some of Ben Hart, and I was talking about my friend Rob James last night, that, you know, Ben Hart's up there doing a Gypsy Fred, and he's kind of going, I don't believe I'm saying this, it seems quite basic, but it's not, you know. The reason why we keep getting drawn to these classic tricks, you know, the egg on the fan, you know, when he does the egg on fan, it's incredible. The reason we keep getting drawn to this is because these classics just don't go away. It's like yoga, right? It's still around after thousands of years. And why is it? Because it works. You know, meditation. And these classic tricks work because they're just so, you know, you take a piece of thread, break it into pieces, it's miraculously, you know, it's miraculously complete, can't think of the word then. Again, you know, restored, that's what I'm looking for. Magician's forgotten the word, restored. Yeah, a cut and put together rope, you know, that flameless routine. I'm very, very tired. So, you know, I think it's really important to go back to these classic tricks again and again and again and just do them well, do them solidly and understand that that's kind of where it all comes from. You know, we look around the dealers and we look for the next thing and it's like, again, what we were talking about yesterday, don't look for the next thing, it's already there. And we'll come back to that in a minute as well. So Ben Hart, Jay Sankey, really good. I caught a little bit of Max Maven. Again, it all overlapped and I couldn't get to it. But the bit I caught, you know, he's just someone, again, very comfortable on stage, been doing it for so many years. Very solid stuff, you know, mentalism, but also works in a magic. Obviously, he's got Brave, which he talks about, B-Wave, or whatever you want to call it. And my friend who was at the lecture, the whole lecture, said it was all very commercial, very solid stuff. I don't even think I'm going to catch Max's show tonight because it clashes with something I want to see. But we shall see. And then after that, it was the Gala show, which I want to get onto in a minute. Before that, can I just say, I kind of mentioned it yesterday. A lot of people came up to me and said how much they were enjoying the review show yesterday. And what I realised is that when I said I got sort of tired of the magic world a few years ago, and I've started to realise I don't think it was just the magic world. I think it was me. I think there's a lot of ego in magic. There's a lot of ego in professional magic, as we know. But there's a whole world of magic I didn't notice before. And that's because I've decided to be a hobbyist again and actually learn for the sake of learning and not look around the dealer's hall for the thing that's going to make me the best magician in the world, but look around the dealer's hall for the thing that's going to allow me to sit down and enjoy something, you know, and have that flow experience. And, you know, like a magic book isn't to learn the next routine for stage, it's to sit and enjoy. I've also, with that different shift and different perspective, I've also noticed there's a whole magic world I didn't notice before, which was this really lovely, generous kind of, you know, thanks for doing that thing and let's share ideas and that's going on. And it's very easy to be cynical. So, and I was very cynical before and I thought part of the magic community was cynical, this whole idea of trying to make as much money as possible. But I think that still goes on a little bit. But there is this thing about conventions that it is a really healthy community. And I just want to say, and mirroring that, I'd woke up this morning and someone emailed me, took the time to email me, Tom Marquette, took the time to email me and said, you got mentioned by Magic Orthodoxy, they have a review channel. And I've never mentioned Magic Orthodoxy. And I wonder why I haven't mentioned that. And I think it's subconsciously that thing in me that kind of sees a bit of competition there, which is ridiculous. I mean, Debbie's been doing it for years and there's no competition. I can't compete with that. And that's okay, but why haven't we talked about this? And I think it's a mistake, it's an assumption that there is competition there. And Tom said he's mentioned you and he's shouted you out. And I had a look at that and I was genuinely moved by it. I was kind of like, he didn't have to do that. He's just told his audience, his huge audience about my channel and that they should go and see it. And, you know, bad on me because there's a community with everything we do. There's a community with whatever we do and it's easy to put that, to see it as competition. If you're a professional magician, it's easy to see that we are in competition with each other. And we're really not, none of us are. We have a community here and the magic, the real magic happens, so to speak, when we realize we're not in competition and we get together and share ideas. And I was talking to Sam Fitton about this morning. It's this idea of generosity and giving and Stephen Covey, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, talks about abundance mentality. There is enough for everybody. And that's what I've really noticed in this convention and the session. Is that there's a world that I didn't see before. And there's a really famous saying that is, you know, we see the world not as it is, but as we are. And out of all of this, I think we should go into this with an open mind and a generous mind. And you know, I'm kind of getting on my high horse a bit, but I just want to share what I've taken from the convention as well as dealer stuff, shows, etc. So we get onto the Gala show. And this is, and really don't switch off if you get the chance to see this. The Gala show last night was Arturo Brachetti. I hope I've got a pronunciation right. Now, I remember seeing Arturo way back in the day when I was a juggler in the 90s, TV spots, doing quick change and thinking, that's great. I want, you know, really enjoyed it. But I never saw his whole show. I saw these bits and I think, yeah, it's fine. It's okay. It's good. It's quick change and it's the mime. And I really like that kind of stuff. That's, I suppose, what got me into this thing in the first place, was seeing the sort of the variety, the kind of I love the vaudevillian kind of nature of it. Great. I've heard his name over the years. He's now 62. He did his show last night. And I went into it thinking, this is going to be interesting. It's going to be some quick change and some mime, right? And it started off, I'm not going to go into the details because I really, really think you should see this. There's an image on the screen of a head, and you know, it's there for the whole thing. People are coming into the theatre for ages, and then the animates, and then all of a sudden it looks a bit eerie. And it's kind of got me at this point. And then the lights come on, and straight away I'm thinking, there's something about this that looks really cool, the way it's just this box on the stage is lit. And from this point onwards, I went on a journey, and I don't want to sound too pretentious about this, but I can't explain it any other way. I went on a journey which started off going, this is interesting, this is interesting, this is really interesting, actually this is quite moving, and it just took me for however long it was, I don't know, I didn't even think of the time, on a journey and an experience that it's been so long since I felt something like that, whether a film or theatre or anything. It was probably one of the best shows I've ever seen. It wasn't say it wasn't completely perfect. There were flaws in it, but why was that? People trying to discuss it afterwards, and they couldn't really. There wasn't really the words, and there aren't really words for me to do it justice. So I won't do it justice. To say the show is good is like driving a Lamborghini and say it's quite quick. You know, there's more to it, and I don't know anything about cars, but it's a bad metaphor probably. But it's not good. It was something that wasn't good. And I think that's why art and theatre and magic and all these things exist, because we can't really communicate in words those things that we feel. And everybody's going, brilliant, wasn't it? But it was kind of, they were all confused because nobody could really justify that what they were saying. What it was, you know, people saying, Arturo, he's got these skills, isn't he talented? How many skills can a man have? And yeah, it was that. I mean, you've got the most flawless magic, and magic that looked like real magic. Levitation, just stunning. Lighting, a bit with lasers, which is the best use of lasers I've ever seen in my life. Projections that look incredible. You know, obviously the quick change is what he's famous for, but quick change is almost cheapens it a bit. It's quick change, but it's quick change with feeling. It's mime, theatre, dance, everything. These sand drawings, which moved me to tears nearly, and a dance sequence with a dress that did move me to tears, that literally, not figuratively, literally sent shivers up my spine. The idea of home, the idea of, you know, he looks around his house, and when he's talking about home and talking about it made me want to go home, it made me miss my children. The idea of childhood, it made me miss my childhood. The idea of this shadow that, you know, how much of your life do you control, how much of it controls you, how much of what you do is because you should do it, and how much should we grow up because we're meant to grow up. All these questions are just being answered. And it was an overwhelming, but not overwhelming in a bad way. I came out of the theatre talking about it, but wanting almost to sit on my own and process it. It was one of the best, like I said, one of the best shows I've ever seen. If you get the chance to see it, it's called Solo, which is ironic really, because at the end he brings his whole team on, and you realise that they are, I mean, there's like 80-odd costume changes in it, apparently. They are part of his show. He cannot do that show without those people, as me and Sam were saying this morning. It, not just the costume changes, but the set changes. It's just like he did the thing, he started off in the living room, the telly's in the living room, so he does this brilliant thing about all the different TV shows that we watch, and the costume changes and that, and then the attic is a place for memories. Then he goes into the roof and he creates this whole scene on the roof. I'm genuinely not doing it justice. And when I finish talking about this, I'll think, damn, I wish I'd have said that, and I'll say it next week on a live thing. What it made me think is that we sometimes, as I said before, make the mistake of looking for the next thing with magic. We're looking for the next thing. We're looking to capture something. And I looked on that stage and I thought, that man has captured what we are so desperately trying to look for. He's captured something by not going out there and out there and out there, but by looking inward and not stopping looking, not stopping exploring, not ceasing to kind of dig that creative well where he's just trying, you know, from going to from a quick change artist and just digging and digging and digging and coming up with something last night, which I thought was, at 62, I think was the result of a lifetime of work. I mean, if he goes further than that, amazing, but I just can't stress this stuff. The most magical, the most theatrical, the most immersive show I've ever experienced was on a Saturday night at Blackpool Magic Convention, which I never, ever thought I'd say. So you know what? Hats off. If you didn't see the show, do your best to see it. Go somewhere and watch it. If you've got money, go to Europe and watch it. I just can't stress that enough. It was wonderful. You know, he's found what we've all been looking for. And I tell you what, there wasn't one piece of glitter. There wasn't one ray of light wasted. It was funny. It was, again, you know, maybe a couple of bits that didn't quite work, but it didn't matter for me, but didn't matter. But it, just an absolute master at what he does, through nothing more than dedication, hard work, and just a relentless search for the perfect show, maybe. I don't know. But just wonderful, wonderful. So that, I mean, if you come away from this with anything, do take that from me. Do you know, make it your life's work to see that show. God, you're going to be so let down. Nothing lives up to that, does it? But there you go. After that, how can you follow that? But everything is valid, by the way. That's the other thing. People saying, well, you see that and it's either inspiration, it's kind of depressing because you're never going to reach those heights. It's not about that. It doesn't belittle everything else we do. I don't think it belittles the fact we do a Four Eyes production. It's a different thing. If it inspires us to see a Four Eyes production differently and maybe come into it from a more theatrical perspective, brilliant. But if it doesn't, it's not one or the other, okay? So, you know, when I went into the Eversons after that, yes, there was a thing of how can I go from that thing, which has probably changed my life in some way, to seeing a mind-reading act. And what I will say is that the Eversons were, I have literally no idea. So you go, it's more impressive because you know it's two-person coding. They're a two-person mentalism act. And they are, we know they're coding, right? We know that they're coding. That makes it better, right? I thought, well, if we know that, how's that going to be fun? That makes it better because you even though you know they're doing it, you go, well, how can you code that when you've said nothing and it's a number and it's a six-digit number? I have not seen mentalism as fooling as that. And it might be my memory of it, but I'm sure there was a book test where he got a book from someone in the audience that had bought a book that day, told them to open it, them look at the, he didn't even look at the page, and on stage, she gets the number of the page and the word. I don't know, that surely didn't happen, but that was what I witnessed, which was a really good example of how we misremember things, maybe. But I'm sure at the time we were looking at each other going, how did he do that? I had no idea. I will say that for an hour of it, it was so strong that it was strong, 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 strong. And for me, not being a mentalist, even though it was deeply impressive, a few times I was still kind of going off and thinking about Arturo's show. That isn't to put down the Eversons show at all. It was just such a different thing. And then it was the Matt King show, which nobody could get into, it seems, unless you were there an hour before. I kind of went, oh, right, that's not going to happen. I did see Matt King. I've seen his show. It would have been the same show I saw in the session. I'll review it if you want. It's brilliant. It's hilarious. Everything about it's great. And I would have said that had I seen it or not, so I can't report back on that, but I don't really need to. I did go to Beat the Wand. If you don't know what Beat the Wand is, Beat the Wand is it started, I think, 11 years ago in the back of the bar, and the idea is kind of like a gong show. You go on, you get a minute to do what you do, and then people sort of basically boo you off if you're rubbish, or keep you on if you're not. Sounds really brutal, and I'd heard about this over the years. I've never made it, and I was actually quite glad I didn't get into Matt King, because I thought, well, I actually need to talk about this. What I was really surprised at was the level of it was. It felt very good-natured, even though it was brutal, and it was about booing people off, and there was some very kind of rude, you know, arguably offensive stuff going on. It felt like a family, and it felt like a really. Do you know what it felt like? It felt like normal people having a really good laugh. It didn't feel like a lot of magicians at a magic convention, and that's not a good or bad thing. I was just really surprised at the good feeling and the good atmosphere in that room, even for the people, you know, even for people shouting off, off, off. It was with a good nature. I thought it was going to be a lot more sneery, and I thought it was going to be almost a lot more sort of tacky and geeky. I really enjoyed it. I didn't stay for the whole thing because it was late and I'm old. but I would have had it not been so packed. And it's packed for a reason. The host, Sam Hurst, did a brilliant job hosting it. Again, he created an atmosphere. He held the atmosphere together. It started with a song. I don't know who sang the song, I'm afraid, but just a very, very cool thing to do. If you get the chance to go to Blackpool, don't overlook that as just being a thing that goes on when other stuff is going on. If you're an adult, or maybe if you're not, and you've got very liberal parents, go and check that out. So I'll do a roundup of the things that I saw in the dealer room, because people are asking. Somebody said, can you look at the CubeSmith stuff? I will look at the CubeSmith stuff. I think it's an app that allows you to solve the cube anywhere from any situation. Do a genuine cube match, basically. So someone mixes it up and you're basically informed how to solve your cube, looking away from it, from their cube, and match it. Brilliant. Apparently Peter Egging had a good thing. I'll report back. I saw stuff that I'd heard about for ages I hadn't seen. Like Nick Einhorn demonstrated digital force bag to me in a way that I wasn't expecting. And that's one of those tricks that reads okay. And then when you do it, you go, there's so many possibilities. And there's a reason why everybody's using that. I saw that. Gerard Kearney fooled me with a Peak wallet. I've got his Peak wallet, but he's got another Peak wallet, the original one, which is based on a jack system, which he showed me. And I kind of went, how did you do that? And that was really good. Again, I've reviewed two of Gerard's things. Again, beautifully made wallets, but there's this other part of it that fooled me, which I wasn't that happy with. The David Penn, everybody talked about this invisible deck kicker. I kind of half dismissed it. I saw a picture of it and kind of guessed what it was, not for me. He did it for me yesterday morning, and I felt a little bit magical. He did it in my hand, and he turned the thing over, and I'm kind of trying to do this as a layman. I'm not looking for anything. And I thought, I actually like that. And it doesn't have to be an invisible deck kicker. It can be, you can mix it with sleight of hand and do it at the end. And that, again, easy to dismiss. Wayne Fox has got this box, which when you know the method, it's like a destination box thing, but the card's genuine in there. You know the method, it's again easy to go, right. But then you go, hang on. So that was that. There's all these things that people say. I want to say there's not yet one thing which is completely floored me, but I think that doesn't happen anywhere. I think that what usually happens is everybody talks about the one thing and you convince yourself it's brilliant, and then you go on and go, actually it's not that good. Again, Christian's things for sure. These are all brilliant things to do, but the thing I've got from the dealers is that there's less of these gimmicky tricks and more stuff that you can actually take and do. So I don't know what the thing is that everybody's talking about, and maybe tomorrow that will be different. It seems to be the convention of indexes, loads of them, loads of people doing indexes, which is a good thing, really, because if you think about what an index is, it allows you to create miracles with a bit of practice. And close-up pads. I don't know if it's just me, but there's all these beautiful close-up pads everywhere, and I'm kind of going, well, of course, because, people spend thousands on coffee tables, so why shouldn't we spend a lot of money on a thing that we spend most of our lives on? And when I spread a deck of cards on one of these pads, and I'll talk about them in detail. I think I'm going to try and do a proper review of a lot of this stuff, which I will do, of course. This isn't a review. This is just talking about it. I think I'm going to take away from this. I want a really nice close-up pad, because I spend a lot of time now with a deck of cards. And when I was playing with them yesterday and sort of experiencing them, I kind of felt different. It felt like it gave me a nice feeling to use one of those pads. So I will report back in more detail on that. But again, everybody's doing a Vanishing Prop Dog, and there's these, I forget the name, but I will talk about them tomorrow. These other close-up pads that are expensive, but very, very nice. But I'll do more of a rundown. The Prop Dog have got this great, they've got the candle, they've got all that stuff, but I'm going to review that all separately, and I'm going to talk about probably that stuff more when I get back and I've kind of processed it and talked to the dealers and all that. So it's a bit of a long one. Thank you for sticking with that. And thanks so much again, David, for the mention. It makes all the difference. Luke, thanks for getting me on the estate. Every share, every subscriber, every comment, even though I can't answer them all here at the moment, don't think I take that lightly. It's truly appreciated. So before we go, please like, please subscribe. I'm sorry if the audio's wrong. This is all quite rushed, the setup of this. And check out Arturo's show, because it's incredible. Thanks very much, and thanks for Blackpool. I'll be doing another one of these tomorrow, so have a great one. Cheers.